Okay, I think we are ready to start again. Hopefully, the batteries on this speaker will hold for this lecture because I've seen that on the HI Molde X video, there are some of the lectures which are without sound, or at least partly without sound. So I checked the batteries now, and hopefully they will last for this lecture. First today, we will have some more theory on the topic on linear programming, and then we will continue with the curriculum on chapter 4 in the textbook, which is about inventory control subject to deterministic demand or known demand. When you know exactly, or you pretend to know, what is the demand rate, and then you can make plans according to a fixed or known demand. And then the next part will be to find inventory control models when the demand is unknown or uncertain, so-called stochastic, which then will be the next part of the curriculum explained in chapter 5. Also, remember assignment 2, delivery next week, 2 problems, one problem about forecasting and another problem about aggregate planning, where you also are supposed to use Lingo and solve some linear programming models to optimality. So let's first try to well, first go through this document once again. This is regarding the download and use of Lingo. Lingo is, as explained earlier, is a software a programming system which is used to solve linear programming problems to optimality. And this program is installed on the computers on the student labs, on the, but also it's possible to get a free trial version from this website, and the producer's name is Lindu with a D, and the program is called Lingu with a G. And here on this document, you can have some information how to download this. Yeah, well, this is probably last year's because there is a new version, version 14.0, which is the newest version of this program. But anyway, this the use we are of this system in this course is not so advanced, so we will also be able to use an older version of Lingo. And here we can see some system limitation, which is says that we can have 150 constraints, 300 variables, which is more than we need because we are, well, using a few, well, maybe 20 constraints and 10 variables, or around that number. So much less than we actually have the possibility to use here in this trial version. But in a real-world problem, this can be very huge. You can have thousands of constraints and thousands of variables, which makes the problem more, well, realistic and makes it possible to solve real-world problem with this system. And I will, rather than show this one, I will show it in Lingo, this example, because here we have this small problem, which we showed last week. It is a maximization problem. Find the optimal value, in this case, a maximum value. Finding a minimum value will be quite similar. Here we are trying to maximize profit. In another problem, we will want to minimize the costs, which is more or less the same problem. But here, in this example, also explained in the textbook, we have two different variables, the x1 and the x2. And these two variables represent two different types of desks that this company is producing. And these two desks have different profit. Desk X1 will give a profit of 115 per unit, and desk X2 will have a profit of 90 per unit. And we want to find the maximum or the solution which gives us a maximum profit. But then we also have some constraints or restrictions. This could be lots of different types of restrictions, but in this case we have the amount of wood available. And we have three types of wood. As I remember, it was pine and cedar and maple. And these three types of wood have, you have a limited number of square feet available. And you can see that on X1, desk X1, you will use 10 square feet. And on the on desk X2, you will use 20 square feet of this type of wood. And you have in total 200 square feet available. And similar for the other two types of wood. You will have a certain number of square feet used for for each of these two types, X1 and X2. And you have a limited number of resources available. And then solving this to optimality using a program system like Lingo, you can use this push this bullseye, and you will get the exact optimal solution here, which we can see that the objective value, the maximization value, will be 1,740. And this will be achieved when you have an X1 value. You produce 12 units of desk X1 and 4 units of desk X2. And this production will also be within the range of the restrictions given in the three lines of constraints here. You can also have some analyze of the problem here. Row 1 is here given to be the objective function with an objective value of 1,740. Row 2 is the first constraint, row 3 is the second, and row 4 is the third constraint here. And this slack means how much is left on each of these constraints when you will use the values found here as the optimal solution. And that means for line 2, or the first constraint here, you will have no slack, 0. That means that you will use all 200 square feet of that type of wood. On row number 3, which is this constraint, you will have 16 units left. That means that you actually will use only 112 units in the optimal solution. And on row number 4, you will also have no slack, and you will use a total of 220. What is shown here is the dual price, which is the difference in objective value if you increase by 1. So if you increase the available resources by 1, you will have an increased value of the objective function, like here. So let's show this one. And now we have 1,741. As we remember, we had a dual price of 1 on this first constraint. But what is now special is that we will get objective values values on the variables here on the optimal solution, which are given in fraction, which is not actually the integer numbers, a certain number of items. Question?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So also, if you don't specify anything else, you will the program system will assume that all the variable values should not be negative. It should have a value 0 or a positive number. As we can see here, we have the fractional numbers, which is not really realistic when you're producing exact units like this case, a desk. But this is for a linear program which is possible to solve with this the algorithms used here, you will actually deal with fractional values. If we have what we call an integer program instead of a linear program, that means that at least some of the variables should be integers, this will be a much more complex problem, which is not always easy to solve to optimality, at least within a certain amount of time. So this is what was the simple example on this linear program, and I will try to show this also graphically, because it's quite easy to show here in two dimensions. We have only two dimensions, which is the x1 and the x2 dimension. And there, x1 could be the number of units produced on x1, and x2, number of units produced on x2. And then we can show this one as by writing the graph of the first constraint here, 10x1 plus 20x2 is equal to 200. Then, let's see, we can try to find a straight line which will look like this, which means that at this point and at this point, the constraint will meet the x1 and the x2 axis. And this will be at 0.10 and at 20.0. So here, these two values here will be the possibilities where you are only producing either the x1 desk or the x2 desk, and you will have enough wood to make to do that this production. So x1 equal to 20, we'll say 20 times 10 plus 20 multiplied by 0, which is equal to 200. So this is a graphical representation of this constraint. And we can look at the second constraint, 4x1 plus 16x2 is less than or equal to 128, which will be something like this. So I don't think that the scale will be correct with my drawings here, but anyway, here we will have a value of 0.8 at this point, produce no x1 desks and 8 x2 desks, and at this point you will have a value of 32.0, which is also an option here. Produce 32 items of desk x1 and no of desk x2 will be within the range of the second constraint here, according to 128 square feet of that type of wood. And we have the third constraint, 15x1 plus 10x2 should be less than or equal to 220. Then we will have a line looking the scale is not very good here, I think, but anyway, let's try this one. And then we will meet the x-axis as actually at 14.7. And we'll meet the y-axis or the x2 axis at 0.22. And this will now represent the different constraint. What we are now talking about is the what we call the feasible region, the number of possible solution or the possible solutions that will meet all three constraints. And we have also two more constraints about non-negativity, since we have to have a positive number. So that means that we should find a solution which is within this area here. So what is now the red area here is the feasible region, the possible feasible solutions of this problem. And we can try to find the possible optimal solution here by analyzing this region. And the optimal solution will always be at one intersection. There is also, of course, one possibility that you have a number of feasible solutions along one of these constraint lines. But to find the optimal solution, it is actually in a linear programming. In a linear program, it is enough to try to check all the optimal points. This point, 0.0, it is one extreme point. This point, 0.8, is another one. And then we can see this point, 14.7, and 0 is another one. And we have two extreme points here, one there and one there, where at the intersection point of two of the constraint lines. And we can try to analyze and find out solving this, the equation for this line and this line. We will find that the intersection there will be at 8.7. No, 8.6, of course. And this point will be at the intersection with this line and this line, and the optimal point intersection point will be 12 and 4. 12.4 or 12, x1 equal to 12 and x2 equal to 4. So now we have five different possibilities in this small example of extreme points. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And that, and since we know that in a linear program, the optimal solution will always be at one extreme point, we need only to check these two possibilities. And let's try now first 0.0, one possibility. Objective function will then be 115 multiplied by 0 plus 90 multiplied by 0. Second one, 0.8. We will have an objective function or an objective value of 115 multiplied by 0 plus 90 multiplied by 8, which is 720. And we can check the third one, this one, 14.7 and 0. Let's now assume that a fractional value is possible, so 14.7 is a possible x1 value. And this will give us a total of 1,686.7. Try to put in this value for x1 and this value for x2 in the objective function. 115 x1 and 90 x2. Let's now check the fourth one, 8 and 6. And this will now give us an objective value of 1460. And at last, this one, 12 and 4, which we might remember, 12 x1 and 4 x2 will now give us an objective value of 1740, which is the optimal solution here. So here, by checking the five possible options of the object or of the maximum value here, we will find that this one is the best one, and that also was what the Lingo, the LP solver, showed us to be the optimal solution here. When we are talking about linear programs where we can have fractional solution, this is quite easy. It might be a huge problem with thousands of variables and thousands of constraints, but still there is possible to find the exact optimal solution by some mathematical techniques, actually an algorithm called the simplex algorithm, which we are not going to show in detail in this course. But when we have the all the possibilities should be integer variables, like we actually should do in this case, even if this solution was an integer solution with 12 and 4, it's not necessary that we will get an optimal solution in a linear program like this. So when we have an integer program instead of a linear program, we will actually only have a few options, or not a few, usually many options, but we cannot use these mathematical techniques to find the exact optimal solution. So here we will have the blue points here, which is the actual optimal solutions in an integer program, and it's not always that easy to find the exact optimal one. In this case, we were lucky, or the example is quite simple. So we have actually integer solutions at the extreme points, except for this one. But usually you don't have these, the integer solution in the extreme points, and then it might be much harder to find the optimal solution. It's also possible to do a graphical analyze on the objective function here, 115x1 plus 90x2. Just set that one, or that equation, to a large value, which preferably should be higher than the possible optimal solution, and then you will get an objective an equation of the objective function, which looks like this, and you can actually do a parallel displacement until you reach the feasible region here, and then the extreme point, or the optimal point, will be the point where you first meet that line when you do a parallel displacement. So this is quite easy to show when you have two dimension like we have here. We have only two different types of desks, one x1 and one x2. If we had one more dimension, three for example, it could also be possible to show it by using space, that we include one more axis in the space here, and then try to look at a three-dimensional coordinate system and try to do exactly the same. But when we have more than three variables, it's much harder to try to understand this. The principle is actually the same, and you should try to think by three dimensions. Then we are talking about not about lines, but our space in one or two or three dimensions, less than the total number of dimension, and we are trying to still restrict or find the feasible region of the possible solution according to the number of restrictions or constraints. And the principle is actually exactly the same, but then you have to think of more than two or three dimensions, which is quite hard to understand, at least at the beginning, but you should try to think in three dimensions, because that will make it easier to understand. Okay, then let's have a look at the other problem in This one, the other problem we saw last week when we also demonstrated this Lingo system or the LP programming. We will go back to the example about the dense back computers and the production plan, how to produce with an optimal, in this case a minimum cost. And we remember that we had a plan about the workforce in 6 months, the hiring in 6 months, the firing, so how many people should be hired or fired, and also the inventory, which also is a cost there. How much should be stored in the inventory or from 1 month to the next one. And we can try to define the variables. So in this case, we have much more than two dimensions. We have actually six dimensions when we look to this number or these variables, the H variables. We have six more variables according to the firing variables, and six more according to how much should be stored from 1 month to the next one. So a total of 18 variables. And we are now talking about different parameters, and we have the parameter called the CH, which is the hiring parameter, the cost of hiring one worker. And in this case, this is 500. It costs 500 to hire one worker in training and some other cost according to hiring a new worker. So this one is now 500. We are also talking about the cost of firing a person, which here is 1,000. And we are talking about the cost of storing inventory from 1 month to the next one, the CI, which here is said to be 80. So these are now the three parameters we will focus on in this example, but the book also names a few others. We have the CR, which is the cost of producing one unit in regular time. We have the CO, which is the cost of producing in overtime. We have the CU, cost of producing in under time, or not producing actually, but the cost of having one worker going idle. And we can also talk about the CS, which is the cost of subcontracting one unit when you are not being able to produce yourself. You have to buy from one of your competitors. In this example, and also in the assignment, we are focusing on these three cost elements, but in real life, you should also include several others. Then we are also talking about other parameters. We have the NT, which is actually the number of production days in period T. Number of days in month T, which is different from January to February to March and so on. We are talking about the K factor, which we hopefully remember, that is the number of aggregate units produced by one worker in 1 day, found by looking at historical data and analyzing how much is produced in last year, for example, where you had a certain number of workers and a certain number of production days. So this is called the K factor, production of one worker in 1 day. We are talking about the Also, the initial inventory here, which is the I0, which is which here is given to be 500, which means that this example gives us an initial inventory of 500. We have 500 units on stock before we start this planning period. We are similar talking about I6, which is 600, which is the we should make a plan that has also I6 said to be 600. So at the end of the production plan, at the end of month number 6, we should have 600 units on stock. And we are talking about the W0, which is said to be 300, which also tells us that we should have 300 people hired at the beginning of this planning period. And we have the demand, or the forecast, or the forecast adjusted with the inventory level given here, which is said to be demand in month T, like this. So here, these are the cost parameters are constant in this example. This is given, and we can also see that here, that the numbers here are actually the demand or the forecast for each of the 6 months. The numbers here are the K factor multiplied by NT, the number of days in month number T. So this example had a K factor of 0.14. And in January, you had 20 working days, which says that one worker working in January month will produce on average 2.931 items. And similar in February, March, April, May, and June here. K factor multiplied by the NT, the number of days in month number T. So here, we are also talking about problem variables, which is not given, because these are the parameters, given values, the variables which we should now try to find the optimal value of will be the W's, the workforce in period T, the production in period T, the inventory level in period T, and the hiring, number of people hired in period T, and the number of people fired in period T. These are the five variables, or the five groups of variables, since you have 6 values for each of them, and also one initial value for inventory and workforce. And then in this linear programming formulation, we have what we call the balancing constraints here. So we can see that the workforce, the level of the workforce, number of people hired, or number of people employed in month number 1, should be the number of people of the workforce in the previous period, and adjusted by the number of hiring and firing. These are the balancing constraints which needs to be defined to get logic into this linear programming formulation. So the workforce will depend on the workforce in the previous period and the number of hiring and firing in that the same period. Similar, we have another group of balancing constraints here, which says that the production in each of the 6 months should meet the demand for these 6 months and adjusted by the inventory level. So here we know that we have an I0 level or a value of I0 500, which means that we can produce 1280 minus 500, which is 780, and that means that we will not have anything left on the variable I1. Nothing left on stock if you are producing 780. If you are producing more than 780, then you will have a value for this parameter too. And so the production should meet the demand and adjusted by the difference of the inventory level from the current and the previous month. The third group of balancing constraints here are the production level 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, which should be equal to the workforce multiplied by the number here, which is equal to the K factor and the NT value, number of days in month number T. So all these groups are called the balancing constraints, which are balancing the different variables with each other. And then we can give exact values from some of the variables. The W0, the I0, and the I6 are given certain values here. And we can include other values, other constraints, if we want to do that. So this problem is quite similar, this example quite similar to the problem you have in assignment number 2. Still, you have a production plan. You should meet a production plan with a certain demand, and you should now try to find the optimal solution instead of using the manual strategies about zero inventory or constant workforce, which we have talked about earlier in this course. And you will see that this linear program solution, the optimal solution, will usually be much cheaper than any of the other strategies. We can also talk a bit about rounding. We should now first try to solve this problem. And here we can see that we might remember from the extreme strategies of zero inventory and the constant workforce, we had values, almost 600,000. Now we have an optimal solution of 379,000, 320.9. It is found with the values of the variables shown here, which we can now try to see that the W's, the workforce, is given to be 300 in period 0, before we start the planning period. Then we are firing 27.04, and we will have a new workforce in period 1 of 272.95, and so on. Then you are not hiring and not firing anybody until month number 5, and then you are hiring 464 people, and we will have a new workforce of 737.73. And the production with that workforce, with the same or the given K factor and the given NT values, number of working days, will now be given in the parameters shown here. But as we have talked about, this is a linear program solution with fractional values. And it's not always, well, if we are rounding to the closest integer, we will not always get a feasible solution. So to use this linear program solution and try to make a feasible solution, we should actually round upwards to the closest number of workers. So here we should round to 273. 273 will still be here, and then 738. and then we will actually get a feasible solution, but it's not necessarily the optimal solution, but it will usually be close to the optimal solution. So this is called conservative rounding. Round always, in this example, the workforce, which actually will then decide the number of hiring and firing. This number should be rounded upwards to the closest integer number. And then we can try to make a plan with this type of conservative rounding and to see how will this solution be compared to the optimal solution, which has the value shown here, and also compared to the extreme strategies we have seen earlier about the zero inventory strategy and the constant workforce strategy. We take a break now, 15 minutes, and then I will show this example with the solution found by conservative rounding of the LP solution. Okay, wait a minute. I don't need to record that.